Hello and welcome to Hot Issues. Today we have a very, very special and very interesting guest. And we're talking about Mauritius. What does it have in common with Ghana? What are the historical links? Is it possible that the two countries can work together to achieve something significant for Africa? Welcome to Hot Issues. Hello and welcome to Hot Issues, and as I indicated from the very beginning, today we are looking at a very, very special country. We are looking at Mauritius. It has some very impressive records based on the Mo Ibrahim Index and based on reports from the Economic Intelligence Unit. It is also said that it has a very enviable health system, and it is gradually becoming the hub of the financial sector in Africa, and we are particularly privileged to have with us in the studio the Deputy Prime Minister of Mauritius, Honorable Xavier Luc-Duval. I hope I got the name right. Sir, you're welcome to the studio.
Thank you very much for inviting me. It's a pleasure to be here.
What brings you to Accra?
Well, I've just completed a 3-day official visit to Abidjan, and I thought I shouldn't really come to West Africa without visiting my friends here in Ghana. So it's a lovely country. I'm happy to be here.
But are there some formal relations between the two countries?
There are diplomatic relations, but we don't have resident ambassadors. But the countries, over the years now, we see the links are closing and strengthening, and that's very pleasing. In fact, the whole thing started three years ago, when President Mahama, I think he came on a personal visit at the end of the year, and I think he liked the country. And so I was invited here. I was then Minister of Finance, and I liked the country too. So things started moving, and then President Mahama was officially invited to Mauritius. That was a very successful mission. And from then on, I think things have been moving forward, and we now have a number of projects that are going forward.
Has there been any historical relation between the peoples of Mauritius and the people of Ghana?
Well, the whole story started in the 18th century when, during the slave trade, part of the population of Mauritius actually came from Ghana. But since that time, I think things cooled down considerably until a few years ago, as I mentioned, President Mahama came to Mauritius.
Now, you describe President Mahama's visit to Mauritius as very successful. What are the ingredients of that visit? What did he do? How did you receive him? And so on.
He was received officially, so it was a state visit with all the pomp and circumstance. But what I can say is that with Ghana, with the leadership here, Mauritius feels comfortable, and it is a personal relationship that is more important than what you write on paper at the end of the day. And I think that is what it is, the bonding, it is the friendship that has developed between the two governments, in fact, I think it would be fair to say.
Mauritius is noted for the development of its tourism. Are there any things in that sector that you can make us learn?
I'm actually in charge of tourism. It's the third time now that I look after that portfolio. We've been lucky enough in Mauritius. My father, years ago, started off tourism in Mauritius, to have only gone for the high end. Mm-hmm. And you know, when you start high, you can always go down a little bit. When you go down, when you're down, it's much more difficult to go up. So we started with the high end. We have beautiful beaches and scenery, as you have in Ghana. So I think that whatever we have learned, we are very happy to share with the rest of Africa, and especially with our friends in West Africa.
You talk about the high end and the low end. What is that distinction? What is it that makes tourism, you know, high end and low end?
It's a good question. Obviously, the first thing you have is the environment, the scenery, the beaches and the lagoons and the sea, etc. But then what sort of hotel do you build? Do you build a 5-star plus, or do you build a 3-star or a 2-star? And so Mauritius, from the start, I'm talking about 30 years ago, had a no charter policy. Mm-hmm. So you couldn't actually sit on a charter, you know, with your backpack and come to Mauritius. You had to come in a scheduled flight. Mm-hmm. And that was the start. And we started with really very good hotels, which were, in fact, icons at that time in the hotel industry. And we were lucky enough that these hotels were foreign hotels. And so Mauritians tried to stay at that level mm-hmm. most of the time. It's not always the case. But generally speaking, the reputation started a bit fortuitously, maybe. But that's how it started, and everybody tried to keep to that. Obviously, we have three-star hotels, and we have five-star plus hotels. But generally speaking, the brand is a brand of quality, of security, of value for money, and we'd like to try and keep that. But obviously, the good thing is that the local brands are expanding now overseas. And in fact, we have hotels owned by Mauritians in China. Mm-hmm. In Morocco, there's a very beautiful hotel called Royal Palm, which is in Morocco, in Marrakesh. So our hoteliers like to export their brand and their knowledge.
Now, Mauritius is described as a very stable country. In fact, according to the Mo Ibrahim Index, it is one of the few African countries whose democracy is described as full.
Yeah.
What are the ingredients?
Well, I don't know. First, we should ask Mo Ibrahim. But I can tell you how we live democracy in Mauritius. We have a very vibrant press, mostly anti-government, but that means that keeps us on our toes. We have a unicameral parliament, but the opposition, they are very vocal. They have immunity for whatever, you know, sometimes rubbish that they say in parliament, but they have full immunity. I don't know the system here, mm-hmm. but we have one thing maybe that we have in Mauritius, which has been very important in maintaining our democracy, is that ever since independence, our Supreme Court of Appeal has been in London, at the Privy Council. So the Mauritian judges can only go so far, and you can always appeal to London at the Queen's Privy Council. So that has kept our judiciary also on its toes.
But that may also sound like we're not completely independent.
It may, but there's a price to pay for everything. Mm. And we think it's a fair price. I'm personally in favor of maintaining that system because it has worked. Mm. And you know, justice must be fair, must be seen to be fair also. So that seems to work for us, and I'm not saying it should be the formula for everyone, but I think it's one of the things that has maintained our stability.
One of the other things that is described as enviable about Mauritius is its health system.
Yes.
What does it look like?
The health system.
The health system.
Health system is completely free.
Absolutely.
Absolutely free. I mean, in UK you pay for a prescription. In Mauritius it's free. That has its drawbacks because obviously you cannot give that much greater quality if it's free to the whole population. There's some abuse also, people coming in out of hospital for every whim and fancy, but it's completely free. Even if you want to have a cancer operation, if you want to have a heart operation, everything is free. Now obviously we have some private clinics to people who want to jump the queue, etc., etc. We have lots and lots of professionals in Mauritius. I mean, we have probably more accountants per capita than in the UK. Mm-hmm. We have lots of lawyers and we have lots of doctors. So the cost of getting professional advice is not so high. And again, I mean, it has its flaws, but it is completely free. And every year, as you know, as the country prospers, we invest more in the health system and it seems to work reasonably well.
How do you pay for it?
It's paid for by low taxation. People don't understand when I say that, but yeah. In fact, during the 80s, the tax system was so heavy, 75% to 80% of tax on your income. And then brilliantly, one Minister of Finance reduced dramatically that tax rate to 35%. And instead of tax revenues falling, tax revenues increased because economic activity increased so much and people were investing into the country for exporting everywhere, because in some cases it was as low as 15%. Mm-hmm. And then the next finance minister came and said, everybody should be at 15%, in fact. And again, instead of tax revenues falling kept on increasing. So now we have three tax rates in Mauritius, 0%, 3%, or 15%, depending on your activity. And it seems to work. A lot of the tax also is indirect taxation through VAT now rather than through direct taxation. And it's reasonable. Economic activity is quite high. Our per capita income now is nearing $10,000 per person, obviously. Mm-hmm. And that's quite reasonable. But that's a formula that people can look at, mm-hmm. and not go for high tax rates, but high tax revenues. Mm-hmm.
Now, apart from tourism, what do you do as a country?
Okay. In fact, Mauritius is very well known for tourism, but tourism is a very small part of our economy. If you look at the GDP, most of the GDP, not most of it, but the biggest sector is the manufacturing sector, which is about 16% of GDP. Then comes financial services, banks, and the global business sector, etc. Mm-hmm. That's 10% of the GDP. Mm-hmm. Then comes tourism at 7%. After that, you have also the ICT sector at about 7%. And so and agriculture is only 3%. So from independence, where we were basically all just agriculture, now it's come to become a very small sector, and we have been able to diversify.
It has been said that Mauritius is or could become the financial hub of Africa. Is that true? What makes it the financial hub of Africa?
Absolutely. I think everywhere I go around in Africa now, people know about Mauritius, and you hear about people who've invested in Africa and using Mauritius as a base. You read that in newspapers, and I'm sure you've seen it. I think there are many reasons for that, and only a small part of it is fiscally driven. If you looked at our relationship with India, and that's how we built our financial center, it was fiscally driven, because there were fiscal advantages to setting up a company in Mauritius and investing into India. But Africa is different. I think there may be some slight fiscal advantage in some cases, but the main reason are just practical and legal reasons and also stability reasons, if I may put it that way. Mm-hmm. Mauritius is a very safe jurisdiction to invest in. It has monetary stability. We talked about the judicial system. The laws are very, I'm sure, like in Ghana, very clear. They're basically UK-based laws, like company law, etc. Mm-hmm. Reasonably fast way of doing things. And a country that works, ease of doing business. We are always first in Africa. Competitiveness index also. You know, there's things like that. So there are good reasons to set up your company in Mauritius. And if you have a joint venture with anybody, there's also a good reason, because for the things I mentioned, that you would set up in Mauritius, and from there, invest into Africa. The advantage for Africa is that it simplifies the investment route. Mm-hmm. It reduces the risk. Mm-hmm. It reduces things that can happen to you. So it makes Africa a more secure place, if I may say so, a more secure place to do business. And that can only work for the advantage of the whole continent. Now, the huge amount of funds that we now have under administration in Mauritius, the IMF just gave the figure a few weeks ago at $650 billion. That's, you know, a huge amount of money that is under administration in Mauritius. Now, under the right circumstances, this money can be encouraged to be invested in different countries. Mm-hmm. Now, there are things that need to be done legally, so that this money can be safely invested, and sometimes also to avoid double taxation. So these are some of the things that we're doing. We have a number of African countries. We already have a number of obviously double taxation agreements, etc., and we are trying to develop that. And we see a win-win situation in that.
What are some of the legal impediments, you know, to utilizing the $650 billion, that's a lot of dollars in Mauritius. What are some of the legal impediments?
The first thing that people would want, an investor would want, would be to be protected from arbitrary decisions or things that would be unfair. So that is covered in something called the Investment Promotion and Protection Agreement. That is a standard international document that most people use. Now, we are in the process of discussing the signature of such an agreement with Ghana. We have it. In fact, I signed a similar agreement with Ivory Coast yesterday. Mm-hmm. Excuse me. So that is something that I think should be done, because it provides assurance to any investor into Ghana and any Ghanaian investor into Mauritius. It's a mutual recognition sort of thing. Now, that is basically legal protection. Then you would have something that we all want, is to avoid double taxation. You don't get taxed in Ghana, and you again get taxed in Mauritius. So what we look for is the signature of a double taxation agreement. That is under discussion here. Mm-hmm. Once you have these two documents, you may only have one or may have both, but when both are in place, that guarantees the greatest flux of investment into any country. You must understand that, that Mauritius is a tax neutral base. So they, in fact, that avoids abusive taxation also.
Hmm. Are there any indications of a future in which Ghanaians and Mauritians are working together to develop the economies of the two countries? Absolutely. Are there any such indications yet?
I think there are very strong, there's a strong will from both governments that this should happen. As we are in fact at the moment talking to the Ghanaian government. We're setting up a special economic zone, which would have its own administration, which would have its own systems, etc., where we would hopefully, Mauritians would come and invest, but other people also from around the world and from around Africa. But that is a concrete, you know, concrete buildings, etc. Mm-hmm. That takes time, mm-hmm. whether you like it or not. It takes time. And this is something that it needs a special law in Parliament, needs to be passed, etc. You need infrastructure, you need everything else. This is something that we're working on. And hopefully, we are very keen that this should happen. We are also trying to develop the same thing in Senegal, not far from here. And we're also talking to the government of Ivory Coast about different projects. But this is something that we can work on in a concrete way, literally.
Are there some immediate things that we can do
together? I think the immediate thing that we would like to do, and this is why I am here, I would really like to go away with an IPPA, Investment Protection and Promotion Agreement signed. Mm. I think that would be the cornerstone of our relationship, because that would provide the security to both countries' businesses to invest across borders. That would be something that we would do. We would also, at some point in time, like to see an air connectivity. Mm-hmm. Now, funnily enough, in Mauritius, it's a bit far from West Africa, but we have very close relations with a number of countries here. Mm-hmm. We can think of Nigeria, you know, some sort of connectivity through Lagos, mm-hmm. Through down to Accra and Abidjan, down to Mauritius. And Mauritius now is well connected to Asia. Mm-hmm. So that would be also, obviously, but it's not maybe not the best route. Mm-hmm. But also we would like to welcome Ghanaians to come and spend their wonderful holidays with us, like the president did, you know, like the president did.
And some of you coming to Ghana to spend your holidays.
Absolutely.
Also
I love Africa. My best holiday, I haven't been on safari here, but my best holiday was in the Maasai Mara. Mm. A few years ago, my wife, my family and children, it was an unforgettable holiday.
Now let's talk a little more about the political system in Mauritius. How many political parties are there? Obviously, it's a multi-party dispensation. How many political parties are there?
Yes.
And what's the relationship between these political parties?
Yeah, very dynamic political scene. It's a small island, so people, you know, they just care about each other's issues. It's not a big place like Ghana, but we have basically four or five political parties. But the important thing about Mauritius, it's a very multi-ethnic a country, so there are always coalitions. So at the moment, I'm in a coalition where the Prime Minister has the biggest number of MPs. I have the second biggest, so I have the Deputy Prime Minister. There's also a third party. So there's a coalition that also sort of... It's like the French say, you know, you're putting water in your wine. You know, you're diluting. There are less extreme measures being taken. And then the opposition is the same sort of thing. Now, I think what we need to remember in Mauritius is that although in the 1970s, after independence, you had a socialist party, you had a sort of a communist party, but my party, which I now lead, was a social democratic party, more to the center. People sit to the right, but in fact it's the center. And we were always in favor of a democratic system where the private sector would in fact be the driver of job creation and wealth creation. And that system, that belief, that is economic system, is a system that all the parties now accept.
All the parties.
So there's no party that will come up with a different economic agenda than what we originally had. That means that all they will say is, we will do it better than you. That is the whole thing. They don't say, we will do it differently, but we'll do it better because you guys are no good, we're going to do it better than you. So that's a very, very sane, very good way of having economic arguments. But obviously then you have lots of other things happening in the political spectrum.
You seem to have a lot in common with the current administration in Ghana.
Yes.
It's also social democratic.
Yes, exactly.
Believes in the kinds of things that you talk about.
Yes. You know, I travel around Africa a little bit, and I feel very comfortable here in Ghana. Maybe it is because the English system, I don't know, right? It's language also, but we are used to.
But also our ancestors are in Mauritius.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. But when you go to the French speaking, although I speak French and we all speak French in Mauritius also, the system is completely different. And so we feel less at ease. So we're very at ease with Ghana, really we are.
Now, you have a multi-party parliamentary system. You have a prime minister, and you are the deputy prime minister. Is Mauritius a republic?
It's a republic. We have a president. The president is appointed by parliament. She is a figurehead, but she has an important role to do when you have a hung parliament, for instance, things like that. But she also makes some apolitical appointments when it needs to be done. But generally speaking, the big boss is the prime minister.
You have a president who is a woman.
Yes, she's a, yes.
This brings to question the role of women in the politics of Mauritius.
Right. You see, I'm in charge of the committee looking at electoral reform. Now, so the president is basically like the queen. Her powers are like the queen. Now, we feel we have far too little women in parliament, and we are thinking of changing the law so that it would be mandatory for you to present one third of your candidates. I don't know the system here. Mm-hmm. One third of your candidates should be of a different gender. So women, basically. and I think that will come up before the end of the year, and that will have that. But we don't have enough women in national politics. We have the same one third law for the municipal elections, but not for the national elections, not yet, but that will come.
How does the population look like? How many, what is the percentage of women in Mauritius?
Oh, the women are a little bit more than men.
And yet
they get because they live longer, because they live longer. That is the issue. In Mauritius, at least, they live longer.
Okay. Are you hoping that at some point, you know, the participation of women will be enhanced beyond the 30%?
No, I think at the moment, no, well, I think we're about 11% or something at the moment. It's dramatic. So we'll go from that percent to 33%, and then we'll take it from there. But it will be a quota system. But the more that you impose a quota system, you're also somehow stopping people who are maybe very good from coming up, because you have to have so many. You know, Mauritius being a multi-ethnic country, you not only look at men and women, but you have to look at the religion and you know, things like that. So all these little constraints are sometimes at the expense of meritocracy.
What is the extent of the ethnic diversity in Mauritius?
Yes. In fact, we have, there is no majority religious group. We'll talk of religious groups. We have the largest group are the Hindus from a Hindu community. And then we have the Catholic community, which I am a Catholic. And then you have a Muslim community as well. And then very small percentage of Europeans and then Chinese.
Mm. Well, that's not quite a lot. We have 56 here.
Yes, 56.
56 languages,
but,
yeah.
But we have probably every religion in the world in Mauritius. well, I just gave you the big groups.
Oh, okay.
But Mauritius is known for its religious tolerance and for the inter-ethnic relationship, etc.
There are no conflicts based on religion, no conflicts based on ethnicity?
No violent conflicts. There is a bit of competition, especially in politics. Where power is involved, there's always a bit of, power grabbing. but that is within manageable levels.
Mm, mm.
But I may say one thing on that issue. We had some time ago a branding exercise done by a firm called Akanchi. And they came up and said, the strength of Mauritius is the diversity of the population. Every single community, ethnic community, brings something to the table that then ends up in having a powerful economy.
Hello, welcome back to Hot Issues, and we are in conversation with the Deputy Prime Minister of Mauritius. And we've been talking about the historical links between Ghana and Mauritius. We've been talking about some of the opportunities available in Mauritius. Now we want to find out, sir, what exactly are you doing in Ghana?
I'm in Ghana for 24 hours on the way back from Abidjan. So we stop here, meet our friends. We'll be having an opportunity to meet many of the ministers and hopefully President Mahama. We have a number of issues which are ongoing issues which we wish to accelerate in a way. Firstly, as I mentioned, it was the investment promotion and protection agreement we wanted to finalize, the double taxation agreement, and also see how the special economic zone is progressing, so that these things can happen, and we can actually make the relationship much stronger as we go along. This is what we're trying to do. And hopefully, I'm very hopeful that this visit here, followed by other visits by Ghanaian ministers in Mauritius, will pursue our agenda and get it moving.
You've met President Mahama before?
Yes, on two separate occasions.
So what kind of discussion are you going to have with President Mahama when you meet him?
I think I want to enlist his help in getting things moving quickly, so that both countries can get into a win-win situation. The idea is to have a conducive environment for our businessmen to prosper. And I want to say that this is a win-win situation for Mauritius. We're also interested in attracting Ghanaian investments. Now, just one example I'd like to give. Mauritius is now setting itself up as a meeting point for populations. We have taken off visa requirements for 50 out of the 54 African countries. So really it is a meeting place. And on top of that, we are developing an education hub, because we are bilingual, reasonably good education in Mauritius. We want to develop a high quality education hub. We were extremely pleased when the Africa Leadership College set up in Mauritius. Now it is headed by a Ghanaian called Fred Swanika. And it's turning out, I think it'll turn out to be one of the best universities that we have in Mauritius, and it has been brought by a Ghanaian. So you see there are opportunities for both countries and for both our citizens, all of our citizens.
Are there any Mauritius businesses in Ghana already?
There are businesses in the making, especially in the sugar field, where there's a very large project in the north by a company called Omnicane, which is happening. But again, these big projects, they take time to raise finance, to get the right people, etc., get the permits, get the land.
Are you doing sugar in Mauritius?
We are a very, although sugar is a small part of our GDP, we are a very big sugar producer. But now it's reducing because the land is being used for other things. We produce about 500,000 tons of sugar, and which we export to basically to Europe.
That's a lot of sugar. That's a lot of sweetness in a small country.
Yeah. We are very sweet people. I love sweet things. And in fact, but you see, let's talk about intra-Africa trade. I've just been to Abidjan. There you have cocoa. We have sugar. We should make chocolates. Really.
And Ghana has a lot of cocoa.
And we don't. Yes, and we don't. So something is happening. Africa integration has to move forward. I'm a great believer in encouraging intra-Africa trade. Let me give another example. Mm-hmm. We are a big textile producer. 60,000 people in Mauritius work in textile factories. And we use cotton. We use wool. And cotton is all over Africa. But we don't import from here. We import basically from Pakistan because it's much easier, shipping, etc. Mm-hmm. So many things to be done. Now we export our shirts and whatever, dresses, mainly to Europe, to America. We're starting to export to South Africa, but there's no reason why we shouldn't be buying cotton from Africa and selling on the shirts back. And vice versa, other things like that happening. We could sell our sugar to Ivory Coast to have chocolates made. Mm-hmm. So many things that could be done if we encourage intra-Africa trade and intra-Africa investment. Then we wouldn't care about the rest of the world. We'll just look at our own backyard. Mm.
Now you have a lot of sugar, we have a lot of cocoa, and we have cotton, and you have a textile industry and so on.
Yeah.
What are the other linkages beyond cocoa, beyond cotton, and beyond sugar that we can build?
Lots of things. I mean, we were talking about one point in time in encouraging Mauritian professionals to come to Ghana. Doctors, whatever it would be, maybe bilingual teachers, nurses, whatever. So that is the professional services. I'm an accountant, a chartered accountant myself. So the professional services could be provided all over. We need IT guys. For instance, we may need other types of people. So I think we need to have a great exchange of personnel, mm-hmm. because each country would benefit from that, because then it would be filling gaps that we have in our own economy. Mm. That is something. We talked about tourism. Our experience in tourism is considerable, and we could share that. We could talk about ICT and lots of other things, that areas that we could help. But it would be something that would be mutually beneficial, and a two-way relationship, never a single direction only.
Now, you're an African country, and Africa is participating in global politics. What do you think should be the direction of Africa in global politics?
I must say, very frankly, my interest has been in getting Africa to get our own act together.
Fantastic.
That has been my interest. Mm. But so Mauritius is too small to care about international politics and all that. We're not into that line of thinking. We would really like to see the whole area prosper and everybody benefit from that. We eradicate absolute poverty, and you know, we are into a good, stable, peaceful path for the whole of the continent. That is our political aim.
The eradication of poverty is an interesting subject on the African continent. What would you prescribe as some of the steps we need to take in order to achieve that goal?
I was for 2 years Minister of Social Integration in Mauritius, so I was in charge of looking after poverty, fighting poverty. Eradicate is a very difficult thing. We have very little absolute poverty in Mauritius. But I think one of the things that we tried in Mauritius, whether it would work everywhere, is something else, is what we call conditional transfers. We have a welfare state in Mauritius that would be the envy of the Labour Party in the UK. it's such a big welfare state. Free education, free health, universal pension at the age of 60, etc. So, but in fact, you would not eradicate poverty by doing that, unless you really transfer a lot of money. But you would eradicate poverty by making some of these transfers conditional. For instance, now we give additional family allowance if the parents send their children to school, say, at least 95% of the time. That is one of the things. But you can imagine, for instance, that you say you have an unemployed person. He may perhaps not be able to read or write. He may perhaps have an alcohol problem, whatever issue he may have. Then you would say to him, okay, I would give you an employment benefit for 1 year, for 2 years, but that would also require behavioral change from you. Mm-hmm. In that you would follow the courses, you would change your lifestyle, etc. So I believe in conditional transfers. Mm-hmm. But then obviously that's some countries you may not have the economic opportunity. You may have some poverty that is because of geographical isolation, for instance. There are many, many. Poverty is eradication of poverty is a very complex issue. And we look at the cause of poverty, and then you try and help. But there are many causes, but in Mauritius it tends to be behavioral, not geographical. Mm. In other parts of the country. But obviously, good governance is an issue that you have to have. You have to have good political guidance. You need to have an entrepreneurial class that wants to develop, because without them, then you're really stuck in a very poor vicious circle.
Yeah, you scored a lot of marks, you know, economic intelligence units and so on. Everybody says that you're doing very, very well. Does that mean that the levels of poverty and distress are minimal? What does that mean, really?
We have two levels where we measure poverty. One is absolute poverty. I mean, really, you don't have enough to eat, etc., really poor. And that is below 1% in Mauritius. It's very, very low. It is very, very low. The other measure of poverty is relative poverty. How poor are you in relation to the rest of the population? I don't have the exact figure here, but it is higher, because the richer the rest of the population, the higher is the relative poverty. And really in Mauritius, we try and work on relative poverty, because there are people still who are living in conditions where they're unable to satisfy the basic needs that any human being has. And so we try and work on that. And the way that we work on that, as I mentioned, is twofold. One with the welfare state. If you're handicapped, if you're poor, if your mother perhaps with children, etc., that is one way. But whatever the state can give is not sufficient for you to be able to live a decent life. Mm-hmm. It's a reasonable life, but it's not a very prosperous life. So we need to get people from who are receiving these transfers onto another level where they can become economically active and lead a prosperous life. That is the challenge that we see.
Now, many people are listening to you, and if they feel attracted to go to Mauritius, what would they find?
Okay.
How would Mauritius be?
They will find me. One thing. Let me try and describe Mauritius. It's 1,900 square kilometers. It's island, basically, which is surrounded by lagoons, so the open sea doesn't come to the shore. It basically is maybe about 90% of it are beaches, white beaches, and Emerald Sea. Mm-hmm. We've got lots of mountains, so in the middle. Population is 1.3 million, which is quite high for a small island. We have about 50,000, 60,000 expatriates mm-hmm. working in Mauritius in different fields. I mentioned the GDP, the economy. We have five towns and quite a few villages. Some of the villages are bigger than the towns, but they're still mm-hmm. villages.
What about sports?
Sports. We are not into cricket, although we are an English colony. We don't understand cricket. We don't understand cricket, mm-hmm. but we are a football nation. So people like to play football and watch specifically international football. We have lots of people like horse racing, and we have during the season every Saturday horse races. We are very multi-ethnic, reasonably green country.
Hello and welcome back to Hot Issues. And we are particularly privileged to have with us in the studio the Deputy Prime Minister of Mauritius. And we are talking to somebody who leads a country which has lots of Ghanaians, at least ancestors. Now, sir, what is the cultural situation in Mauritius? What is Mauritius like? What is your music like?
Yes. First, I think I should explain that it's a very diverse country. Lots of all the races are there and people get on well, and obviously everyone has his cultural traditions. What we've maintained in Mauritius are the ancestral traditions and languages. So people will probably all speak English and French. Everyone will speak the local dialect, which is Creole, which is very expressive. And after that, as if that wasn't enough, many people will speak Hindi or Urdu and languages like that, ancestral languages. So we have all the cultures are there. And people tend to celebrate their cultures. For instance, we will have Chinese New Year, and that'll be a public holiday. The Marathi New Year, that'll be another public holiday, and so on and so forth. So everybody has a chance to celebrate his cultures, and we tend to participate in that. For instance, for the Diwali, many people, apart from not only the Hindus, but everybody might light lamps, for instance, to celebrate the light festival.
What about the music?
The music scene. Our music is very very lively music. It's called the siga. It's got an African beat. It's very dancing. It's quite erotic sometimes. You know, it's if I can use that word. But yeah. It's lively. Mm. It's people love it. We love it. We all listen to it. But then you will also have people who prefer to listen to Indian songs and watch Bollywood and things like that. So it is very culturally very diverse. Mm. And if you would have to have, say, a Mauritian culture festival, you would have the Hindu culture, you would have the Creole culture, the Creole, which is also the African culture. You would have some French, you would have some Muslim, Urdu, and etc. And you would go on like that. And the Chinese, they have a beautiful Chinese cultural center in Mauritius, very high quality.
What about the Western influence? You have hip hop and
I'm not the best person to tell you about that, you know.
But it's there.
I think so. I difficult for me to venture into that area. You have to ask my sons. You know?
And what about the food?
Food, you would have the same. Eh? You would have the food following the ancestral cultures, but then we have the local Creole food. A lot of it is tomato based. It's beautiful food. It's got a bit of chili, you know, it gets you going. Mm. But it's very nice food. Fish in that sauce, and chicken and beef. It's good food, and people like it. And what we are trying to portray, I must say, I'm also a minister of tourism. We are trying to portray our very culture now to tourists. So if you come, when you come, you have a great chance to see what Mauritius is all about. And in fact, this is what you should do.
So I'm going to ask you to do a bit of prophecy. Now, and looking into the future, what kind of relationship do you see between Ghana and Mauritius in the next, say, 20 years?
Okay. I think we need to look at how Africa is going to develop in the next so many years. I don't believe in Africa developing on the back of a commodity boom. That is, there's no security in that. I believe in Africa developing on the back of good governance, great economic policies, an educated population, an entrepreneurial population. And that is where I think the partnership should be at, in trying to help each other in reaching that goal, based not on trying to sell gold or diamonds, which can be a curse in itself sometimes, but in trying to get the basics right. And I think we would benefit from that, because there's lots of things we can learn from Africa and from the continent. And also we would like to share. We are really looking only at a relationship based on a win-win, because that win-win situation, because that is the only lasting relationship, is when everyone sees that they're getting enough out of the relationship.
So thank you very much for
thank
coming.
You very
thank
much,
you very thank much. You. Well, viewers, we have been in a conversation with the Deputy Prime Minister of Mauritius, Honorable Xavier Luc-Duval, who is in Ghana for a short visit. And mind you, this is a country which has some of our ancestors as citizens. Basically, we are brothers and we are sisters. Well, as I always say, the best is on this station. Best in news, best in current affairs, best in music, best in sports, best in everything. So please stay with us until we meet again next week. It's goodbye from the production team. Goodbye from all of us, cameramen, makeup artists, everybody. Goodbye. Bye-bye.
Brought to you by Gassam Cement and supported by 3FM 92.7 Accra.